Back at 8:35 with an inside look at the Church of Scientology. It is no stranger to controversy. And now, according to a new report, it's being investigated by the FBI. NBC's Kerry Sanders is in Miami with details on that. Kerry, good morning to you.
Well, good morning, Matt. There is always intense public fascination with the Church of Scientology, and now there is an open investigation by the FBI, according to the New Yorker magazine. The New Yorker magazine, in their article, lift the curtain of secrecy on the Church of Scientology, and they expose allegations of alleged, let me get this straight here because I want to get it right, allegations of abusive behavior and gross misconduct in the church's highest ranks. Scientology is often considered both mysterious and notorious for its secrecy and many celebrity members, from John Travolta to Kirstie Alley to Tom Cruise.
It is being a Scientologist, people are turning to you.
Now the FBI is investigating the church, according to a new article in the New Yorker, which reports that the agents on the case are human trafficking specialists. While the FBI doesn't give details of the investigation, the agency confirms to the magazine that the case is open. And the article suggests that the FBI is focusing on Scientology's treatment of its more junior members. In the piece, One of Hollywood's Elite, award-winning writer-director Paul Haggis of Million Dollar Baby and Crash opens up about his 3 decades deeply immersed in Scientology before quitting in 2009. After defecting, Haggis was apparently appalled when he read accounts of how children were supposedly treated in the elite group that helps run the church. He says it reminded him of child slaves he had seen in Haiti. They were 10 years old, 12 years old, signing billion-year contracts, Haggis says, scrubbing pots, manual labor that so deeply touched me. My God, it horrified me. Many former church members are interviewed in the New Yorker piece. According to a former member of the so-called Sea Org, Scientology's religious order within the church, among his many duties, he went to extraordinary lengths catering to the whims of Tom Cruise, such as installing handmade eucalyptus paneling on his customized SUV and plating his motorcycles with brushed nickel and painting them candy apple red, all on a $50 a week salary. The church denies the account, as does Tom Cruise's attorney, who told the New Yorker that the church never expended any funds to the personal benefit of Mr. Cruise. There are shocking allegations of physical abuse by the church's leader, David Miscavige. A dozen people told the magazine they experienced or witnessed it. And one former church executive tells the New Yorker the church had struck or beaten him on 5 occasions. The Church of Scientology denies this claim too, and most of the allegations in the New Yorker piece. And as for Haggis, he wonders why he was so blind for so long. Haggis tells the magazine, I was in a cult for 34 years. Everyone else could see it. I don't know why I couldn't. Early this morning, a Church of Scientology spokesman, Tommy Davis, issued a statement denouncing the New Yorker article. In part, Tommy Davis says, it's unfortunate that the New Yorker chose to introduce its readers to Scientology through the eyes of an apostate, someone religious scholars unanimously denounce as unreliable. The article is little more than a regurgitation of old allegations that have long been disproved. Matt, the church tells NBC News it knows nothing about an FBI investigation.
Kerry, thank you very much. Lawrence Wright is the author of the article, Paul Haggis versus the Church of Scientology, featured in the latest edition of The New Yorker. Larry, good morning. Nice to
see
you.
Good morning, Matt.
Talk to me about your process here. Any investigative journalist wants to get both sides of any story. You clearly had access to former members of the Church of Scientology. What access were you given to current members or the leadership of the church?
At the beginning, I had a lot of access. I met with some of the current members of the church. I was supposed to have met with Tommy Davis, who's the chief spokesperson, at the very beginning of this process. He promised to take me through Scientology, and I went out to Los Angeles to do that with him and spent a couple of days waiting in a hotel room, and then finally he came and said he'd decided not to talk to me.
When you spoke to these former members of the church, did they share a common story? Did they have shared negative experiences with the church, or were their stories very different?
People inside the churches, their stories were very much the same. They had gotten a lot out of this religion, and they felt a lot of adherence to it. The people who had left also had kind of a common story. First of all, they hadn't gotten what they had expected from Scientology.
What did they expect? Promised.
Well, Scientology promises to take you to a higher level, a spiritual level, and also a higher intellectual level, be able to control your career, to have enhanced powers, to not get sick, for instance, and things like that. And people began to realize that those things weren't really materializing in their lives.
One of the things that comes out in the article is this reported investigation of the church by the FBI. And the church sent us a fairly lengthy statement overnight. And one of the things they address is that FBI investigation or reported investigation. Bear with me. As for the claim that the church is the subject of a federal investigation, the church has never been advised of any government investigation, a fact the New Yorker knew before it went to print. Moreover, the subject of the alleged investigation was recently raised in a lawsuit by the same individuals who are the sources for the article, and the complaint was resoundingly dismissed by a federal district court judge. The New Yorker was aware of this fact, but irresponsibly sought to use the claim of a, quote, investigation to garner headlines for an otherwise stale article containing nothing but rehashed, unfounded allegations. How would you respond to that?
I was talking to a lot of people who had talked to the FBI, so naturally I bumped into their investigation. And I talked to people in the FBI who
they confirmed the investigation to you?
They confirmed it to me.
What exactly are they investigating? What are they looking into, according to your reporting?
The sources I talked to have talked to the FBI about three different things. One is the physical abuse of members of the church by the leader of the church, David Miscavige. I talked to 12 people who had either been physically abused themselves or had witnessed such actions on the part of the church's leader.
Just curious, not to interrupt you, why would that be an FBI investigation? Why wouldn't some local law enforcement group look into that?
Human rights abuses, and also it goes to trafficking, which is the FBI agents who are involved in this investigation, their assignment is human trafficking. And it's forced prostitution. But the laws are defined in such a way that confinement, psychological abuse, being placed in a psychological spot where they're pressured not to leave the environment, a lot of these things resemble things that people who had been in this clergy of Scientology called the Sea Org have been complaining about.
As someone who now has spent a lot of time looking into this church, when you think of some of the high-profile people who are members and the people whose names get bandied about a lot, Tom Cruise and John Travolta, Kelly Preston, Kirstie Alley, they are smart people. Mm-hmm. They seem to be very happy with their lives. Mm-hmm. And you know, why would they still be a part of this if it is the church that is doing all these things wrong, as so many pieces like this seem to portray it?
That's exactly why I got into this story. When Paul Haggis, who's the subject of this profile, dropped out, the question that naturally occurred, why would somebody so intelligent and creative and successful have been in the church in the first place? What did it give to him? And really, at some level, it was very rewarding to him. You know, he had some marital problems, and he went to the church for counseling, and he felt that he got something out of that. But on the course, as he went all the way to the top of Scientology at the time, he was called an operating Thetan 7, which is the highest level available. And he got less and less, he felt. He felt more and more false.
But as for these other people, are you suggesting in any way that they are part of some kind of cover-up? Or have they simply lived an experience within the church where it remains rewarding for them?
I think it is rewarding for them, but there are two levels to the church. One is the public, which is the way that Paul Haggis lived in the church. And the other is their kind of clergy, which is called the Sea Org. And it's kind of a monastic order, and these people commit for a billion years because they feel like it's an eternal service. And they get paid as little as $50 a week, and they're subject to rather extraordinary confinement. I mean, there are these kind of re-education camps where some of them are sentenced for more than a decade. And if they try to escape, they're dragged back into it.
And let me just end by saying that in that statement from the church, they say that anyone who wants to know the true story of Scientology should find out for themselves by coming to a church of Scientology whose doors are always open, or going to the church's website. Larry, thank you for coming and talking about your article. I appreciate it.
It's a pleasure, Matt. Thank you.